When you get started in family history, you'll quickly find out that you've got to decide how you want to organize it. Do you want to keep your information that you find stored digitally? Do you want paper files? Do you want to use a blend? And this is entirely up to you, but it is a decision that needs to be made. Let me share some thoughts that I have about organizing family history. First, know that it's going to keep growing. So, done. Everyone in the family tree has been found and everything's perfectly organized, including the photos, said no genealogist ever. So don't feel badly if you end up with piles of paper and photos that you need to scan in and all kinds of stuff. You're not behind. You can't get behind in a project that's never done. So here's a good rule of thumb for keeping documents. Unless you are the repository, backed up digital files are sufficient. Let me explain what I mean by this. For census records, I'm not the repository. The National Archives is the repository, and those records are available easily for free on Ancestry, on Family Search, any record that's available online or at a repository easily is not worth keeping a paper copy of yourself. You can attach a digital file and that's sufficient. On the other hand, there are files for which you are the repository. And I've got images here of two of them in my own files. The first one on the right is my great-great-grandmother's baptismal certificate. I'm the only one who has this. It was stuck inside a family Bible that I inherited from my great aunt. And it would be very difficult, if not impossible, to get a copy of this. And because of that, I keep it. Next, next to it, the one with the red ribbon and the seal, that is my great-grandfather's Social Security application that I wrote away for. Now, I could order another copy if I needed it, but it costs $30. So, and I'm the only one who has one. So I'm going to keep that. But of the paper files I keep, and I'm pretty serious about family history, all of the paper that I have fits inside a single file folder. So I'm not saying you need to do it that way. I'm just saying that you do not need to feel obligated to have reams and reams of paper and binder after binder on your shelf or filing cabinets filling an entire room in your house. So if that's something that stopped you from working in family history, don't give it a thought. Digital files are just fine. Now, of course, you have to make sure that you're backing them up. That goes without saying. Well, maybe it doesn't, but you do need to be backing them up. But digital files are just fine unless you're the repository. Now, let's talk about those digital files, because even if you are a paper person, you're going to have digital files. So I think it's important to create a naming convention for digital files. And the naming convention I use, I got from Thomas McEntee, who got it from someone else, which is I use the person's name, last name first, and then the birth date. Now you'll notice here, see this, Gates Alfred, 1885, and then notice here, Gates Alfred, B, 1816. Those are their birth years. And that's because they were, there's a father and son, and they're born, they have the same name, but they're born in different years. So I can tell which Alfred Gates it means by whether you were the one born in 1885 or 1816. So I put the last name, first name, when they're born, and then what the document is. So this is it. Last name, first name, birth year, document. Aurel Christopher, born 1841, death certificate. Aurel Christopher, born 1841, index to pension. So he was, this is my third great grandfather, and he fought in the Civil War, and this is a pension record. I'm not the repository. This I am. Do you see this? This death certificate was actually part of the actual pension file that I wrote away from. So I did keep the pension file because I am the repository for the actual physical paper. Some people like to do color coding. They'll color like their mother's side yellow and orange and their father's side blue and green or different colors. And I try doing that because I think it's pretty and I really like it. But the problem that I ran into was twofold. Number one, you start going back farther and farther and it becomes useless to you because you have this huge swath of purple and what good does that do you? But the other issue I had was that I had a lot of blue and red make purple because I had distant cousins who had married from two different lines of the family. So like a distant cousin of my mother's had married a distant cousin of my father's, and then I ended up with people who were on both sides. So the color coding didn't work for me that well, but lots of people like it. And if it's something that appeals to you, give it a shot. Just Google color coding for genealogy and you'll find lots of conventions for it. Next, decide on where you're going to keep your trees. And you don't have to be the King of England to get a complicated tree. Even the most basic of us, it escalates quickly, right? You have, let's see, how many is this? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. You have 512 seventh great grandparents. So you need to keep track of it. And you can do that in a couple of ways. You can use online trees available at lots of places. Family Search, I have big because it's free and anybody can use it. And it is trying to create a big, huge family tree. So this is the important difference to keep in mind. Family Search, it is not quote unquote your tree. In Family Search, it's working on the great big family of man. So it's a Julie Andrews spinning on top of the mountain. Look at all the people in the great big shared tree. What that means is that people can change it and they can change quote your ancestor, but it's other people's ancestor as well. On sites like Ancestry or Find My Past or My Heritage, you create a family tree and no one can touch it, right? You can do it and nobody can make changes to it without your permission. So when you're looking at online trees, you have to decide, is it important to you that nobody be able to adjust your tree? I highly recommend that you also have a desktop tree. You maybe don't necessarily need to start with this from the right out of the gate. But, and I don't necessarily recommend any of these in particular. I've used two of them and been happy with them. Look around, see what features they have. Watch some tutorials on YouTube to see which ones look like they're the easiest for you to use. But what a desktop tree does is it lets you have your information on your own computer. Because what the cloud is essentially just someone else's computer. And so if you have it on Ancestry and then you decided not to keep up your Ancestry account or something happened and Ancestry went out of business, you would lose your tree. That's less likely with Family Search. And if Family Search stops hosting the tree, then we all have bigger problems. But you still want a desktop tree, and many of them will sync with Family Search or sync with Ancestry. So if that's something that you would like, look into that. So, that is the basics of organizing your family history. And I know it may seem overly simple that I just showed you a few things, but the fact is that that's what it is. That's what it's about. It's not that difficult. Decide on a naming convention. Decide if you want to use digital or analog or a combination of both. Decide what kind of paper you're going to keep and decide where you're going to store your tree. And then you're ready to get going.